All right, the president of the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis is telling the Financial Times that credit problems in the United States will roll on for many months and might, in fact, get much worse. Whitney Tilson is managing partner of T2 Partners. He's our guest host for the rest of the morning. Also, Steve Leisman is our senior economics reporter. And, Whitney, that does not sound like it's entirely out of whack with what you've been saying as well.
Absolutely. It's good to see it's good to see that the leaders at the Fed are, I think, acknowledging the reality that this was probably the largest bubble in financial history and that it's not going to burst quickly and painlessly and go away quickly. That I think he said a few, it's going to go on for a number more months. I'd say a couple more years at least.
And Steve, how should we be putting this in context, these comments that we're getting this morning?
Well, you can take Stern out of the column of those Fed presidents who want to hike sooner rather than later. We know that maybe Plosser from Philly is one of them. And then there's Fisher from Dallas. We aren't quite sure where Stern stood. Now it seems like he's somebody who's willing to wait. He is concerned about inflation, but he thinks there is time to wait before what he calls expectations become unanchored. So that's the way to look at it, willing to give the credit crunch time, pointing to a Fed that's on hold, Becky.
You know, Stern, you mentioned Stern. You mentioned that you're keeping the scorecard. If you had the scorecard on the two sides, who wants to go early? Who wants to go a little later?
You know, I think everybody wants to go early. Everybody wants to raise rates and take away the accommodation, who I've talked to in the past several weeks. The question is, when do they feel they can do that? I don't think Ben Bernanke does. I don't think Don Cohn does. I don't think Tim Geithner does, because they're aware of what's happening. And they're also aware, Becky, what's interesting, how quickly the financial dynamic changes. And if you think about GDP, it's sort of like this long amplitude, and inflation, same thing, whereas the financial market goes up and down like this. And just when they think that the woods are clear, they can go out and they can hike rates, the credit crunch rears its ugly head again,
Steve,
and puts them on hold.
Steve, let me interrupt you for a second. Kraft is indicated up almost a dollar, and it's a $29 stock. And, you know, you try and buy, I guess you wonder, why do you try and buy things like that in a recession? 58 cents versus an expectation of 50. For the year, the company, or the Wall Street's at $1.89. The company says that it sees at least $1.92, so it's going to beat for the year. What Buffett, he's in Kraft. You're back, right? You're back. You can do the Buffett imitation. Why'd you buy Kraft, Warren?
I don't know the answer to that question. I just look for intrinsic value.
I don't think whatever happened in the economy, this is going to do very, very well. Kraft, don't you think? Whitney, you know him pretty well, don't you? Can you do it? By the way, did you see the balloons we put up because you're in here today?
No.
It's on your shot. Look at that. It's on your shot. It's a party.
Never mind the fact that they're black balloons,
yeah.
Right?
But no, seriously, Buffett's in Kraft. Right?
I believe so. But is he still in Kraft right now?
I don't remember. I don't think he's been. I don't recall anything he's been buying recently. But it's the kind of thing he would buy at certainly
would
the right price.
Would he answer that way for why he bought it? He would say, I think they're going to do just fine. I mean, it's got a lot of cheese. So
I'm not in the comments.
Right. I'm actually sort of surprised. I would have, if you had asked me, Kraft's about to report, I'd say no, simply because rising commodity costs have got to be killing them. It's very hard to pass along those price increases through to consumers who are hurting these days. So it's the kind of thing Buffett would buy at the right price, but I think he'd be looking for a much lower price these days.
All right, Steve, back to you.
I was wondering the same thing. Whitney was wondering whether or not they're able to pass along prices. I'm going to search their press release right now because they were hit by the commodities. I guess, you know, you're going to buy that cheese stuff, right, either way, no matter what's going on out there, if the price is 50 cents or 60 cents higher. That you're going to do, and that's the sort of thing the Fed has been watching. But one thing, Joe, to think about is these lower oil prices are going to help the inflation story, so that's going to give the Fed a little more room perhaps to stay on hold and do a little more stuff that it's trying to do when it comes to the credit crunch.
Jack Berugin in Chicago, you got any thoughts on Kraft or credit or anything else that we're talking about this morning?
Well, you know, a little bit of both. I think Kraft tells you something. One, that earnings obviously are surprising people and will continue to surprise people. I mean, you know, we've been hearing the story time and time again. We lowered our expectations so much and to such a degree that now every time we have a company like Kraft come out and report, we're getting all excited about it.
Jack, yeah. I got a quick question for you. I was looking at the journal on the left-hand column this morning, and I understand that you can go crazy X-ing out this, X-ing out that, and what they did is they took out autos and they took out finance and they took out oil, and they came up with, hey, this core profit thing up only 2.8%. Are you still excited by that metric?
Well, no. You know what? Remember, you've got to take the wholesale inflation, aspect into account. You know, I don't like the way they start to take out. I mean, I agree with Rick Santelli. When you start to X out this and X out that, you know, you start to really skew the numbers to a degree. But let's go back one thing. You know, when we're talking about what Stern said to the FT, two things to keep in mind. One, remember the audience he's speaking to, and that is the European audience, which right now is suffering greatly because of what Trichet is doing. Remember, you've got a German economy falling off the cliff. France, Portugal, Italy, these economies are really struggling. So now there's a balancing act between the two central banks. So, again, I think there's a little bit of jockeying there and a little bit of rhetoric. And the reality is that, Steve, you're absolutely right. If oil continues to come off, all these wholesale numbers are going to get skewed on the inflation front, and you're going to have a Fed that's sitting back and won't have to do a thing over the course of the next few months. Let's hope that's the case.
All right. In May, Berkshire upped its Kraft Food stakes to 138 million shares from 132 million just in May. So you're the Buffett watcher, right?
Yeah.
And did you mention that they're boosting their view for the year?
No, yes. I just saw one on it.
You mentioned in the Kraft report, not only did they beat, but they boosted their view for the year.
They didn't boost their view. The view that they're giving it, I don't know whether they boosted. Did they? Because it's above where Wall Street is.
Yeah, I think they saw 154 for the year, now looking at 190.
Also, they talked about pricing. You guys were wondering how they were doing this with higher costs that were coming in.
Right.
Pricing is being helped out. They talked about lower marketing costs, but also higher prices that they're passing along in the U.S. grocery business, in the U.S. cheese business, in the U.S. beverages business. So in all of those areas, they talked about how operating income was up in each of those areas, in part because they are passing on some higher prices.
Well, let's also keep in mind that dairy has been one of the most volatile commodity groups, over the course of the last few months. I mean, we've seen cheese, we've seen milk spiking out of control. Remember, this was an industry that was government regulated to just a few years ago. So all of a sudden, the need for risk management is there, and we've seen exactly what's happened. And more importantly, we've seen these price increases passed on and absorbed by the public. I'm going to be really surprised if Disney doesn't beat over the course of the next couple hours here when they report, because, you know, more importantly, I think that you're seeing a continuation of these multinationals doing much better than we thought.
What does that mean for GDP on Thursday, Jack?
A nice, pleasant surprise. I think that, you know, everybody is looking for such a bad number, you know, just as we were looking for durable goods last week to be, you know, an Armageddon-type number. So I think anything short of the negative feelings that we are having over the course of the next few days is going to be a pleasant surprise. And not only that,
Jack,
but look for unemployment to also be a surprise on Friday.
That would be a surprise, but I would just venture that, Jack, I see a 2% number built in. You're right. It could be an upside 2.3, 2.4. But the trouble is that the naysayers, and I guess I got to count myself among them in this category here, are going to wonder, have you pulled forward growth from the third quarter? What a third quarter growth number is going to look like without the rebate checks, which have pumped up spending in the last quarter?
Well, you know, everyone's talking about the rebate checks. Everyone's talking about the impact that they're having. You know, the reality is that we're seeing it absorbed into the economy. But over the course of the next couple of months, I think the key is going to be commodity price inflation. And that's one of the things. And it's not only the price of these things coming off.
I'll go with you on that, Jack.
It's stabilizing, Steve. It's stabilizing. We want to see it go sideways.
That's a totally legitimate point, that if you have the commodity price decline, put some money back into the pockets of consumers and offsets the decline of the rebate checks, that could be a very pleasant surprise.
I'm not even talking about a decline. I'm talking about a stabilization.
Just stop going up.
If we stop seeing these prices go up, I think that the economy will absorb it. It's already proven that it can.
Right. All right, guys. Thanks for that. We should mention non-GAAP, they're only raising the view 2 cents for the year from 190 to 192.